Hey there, welcome to the Not a Number. My name is Ricky, and today we're going to be developing this snake-style game. It's developed with HTML5 Canvas element and pure JavaScript. There are a lot of JavaScript libraries out there that could probably make this a little bit easier, but it's a pretty simple game to make, and I think it's always fun and interesting to do things in vanilla JavaScript. And so if I just start the game here, you can see that the character moves around. You can run over the food, and it grows just like you would expect. And it does have edge collision detection, so if I hit the edge, the game is over. And it will also detect colliding with yourself. So if I just eat a couple more pieces of food here, I should be able to run into myself here like that, and the game is over. So again, it's pretty simple. We do this with vanilla JavaScript, so with that, let's get started. Alright, so let's get into it. I'm going to close out this window here, and you can see I have another snake page here that's completely empty. If I take a look at my code real quick, I have two files in this directory, the snake directory, that is an HTML file, and then this snake.js file. So in the HTML file, you can see it's pretty simple. I just have a title. I am importing the snake.js file. And then in the body, I just have one canvas element. The snake.js file is empty, so let's get started. So to get started, I'm going to create a game object. And what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to put it inside a self-executing function like this. And what that does is it evaluates the function and then executes it immediately and stores the result inside of this game object. And there's an important reason that we want to do that, and that's to help protect our game from some end-user tampering, which obviously that's not a big deal for a snake game, but let's say you're making a real full-fledged game, especially something like a multiplayer game in the browser with JavaScript. It's important to do this because JavaScript is a language that's compiled at runtime. It's not pre-compiled, so the end-user has access to your source code. And so you have to make sure that you protect it from manipulation by the end user. So let's just say, for example, I created this as a regular object, and I had a settings object in here, and one of the things I stored is the tick speed of the game. Then I'm going to set it to 2500. That's going to represent milliseconds. And let's say I have a function called gameTick here. And it's going to do whatever you want to do during your tick. And I'm just going to have it right now console. Game tick. And then we'll set timeout and have it call the game tick on the interval of game.settings.tickSpeed. So if I run this in my browser, should see it log. Oh, sorry. I do have to call it the first time. So now if I refresh, you can see game tick getting called every 2500 milliseconds or 2.5 seconds. But let's say your end user was messing around in their console here and they saw this code. And they're like, huh, this is out in the open. I can just change this tick speed, right? I go in here and do game.settings.tickSpeed and set this to 100 milliseconds. All of a sudden, GameTick's going to get called a whole lot faster, and that might give me an unfair advantage. Now, if I go in here and change this to this self-executing function I told you about, since this is a function, this is no longer an object, it's a function, I need to change this to a variable. So settings is a variable now. Tick speed is a method inside of the settings object. And I'm going to move this game tick function inside here. And now this is just going to be in settings.tickSpeed. And in order to be able to call this gameTick function, I need to actually expose it. So I'm going to return because again, this is a function call. I just need to return something into this game object. So I'm going to return gameTick as this function gameTick. Now I should be able to call game.gameTick. Oh, sorry, this I got rid of. So down here I can call game.gameTick, right? And that should loop it. Should do the same thing, right? So we're getting gameTick and it's going to get called every 2500 seconds. But if I look at this game object now, all I see in here is this gameTick function. That's all I have access to. I don't have access to this settings anymore. Even if I go into my sources, I can see it in the source code, but I have no way from the global scope of accessing this settings object. It's only accessible inside of this anonymous function. So that's a good way to protect some of your code and make it so that your end users can't manipulate certain things. All right, so now that we got that out of the way, a little sidebar there, I'm gonna get rid of some of this stuff that we don't actually need. The one thing I am gonna keep is this settings object, but I don't need tick speed in there. So when you think about how we're gonna design the snake game, the first thing that we obviously need is a grid. Then we're gonna need a snake that needs to be able to move around. We need to be able to detect if it's gonna collide with itself or with one of the sidewalls, or with the food for that matter. And then we need some sort of food object that gets placed around the game board. So we're gonna kind of take those kind of three chunks. So the first thing that we're going to need is game board, and that's going to be the very first thing that we're going to need to do. We know we're going to need some initialization, so I'm going to create a function that I'm going to call init. Sorry, simplified init is equal to function, and we'll do some initializing in here, right? And again, I'm going to end up calling this from the window onload function. So I need to return init as init, right? So this is what basically the parameter will be. So it'll be game.init, and it's going to be equal to this init function. And then we can even just check this as a sanity check. So I'll just put initializing in here, console log initializing. And then I'm going to do window.unload as a function. Sorry, in those parentheses. And then we're going to call game.init. And then if we go into our browser, look at our console, and refresh, we should see initializing in there. And so I'm going to put a couple settings in here that we're going to need for our grid. So I'm going to make each individual square 25 pixels square. So I'm going to put a property in here I'm going to call cell size and set that to 25. And then I'm going to make this 15 squares wide by 15 squares tall. So let's make a width property of 15. That'll be 15 units. And then the height is going to be 15 units as well. So we can use those to change it if we want to. Now, when we initialize, what we're going to want to do first is draw the grid. And I'm going to do this inside of a draw grid function. So let's go down and make a draw grid function. So inside of draw grid, we need a few variables first, right? First thing that we need is our canvas element. We need to know where we're going to draw this, right? So let's create a canvas variable, and we're going to set that equal to document.getElementById canvas. And if we go back and look at our HTML real quick, we see that we have a canvas object in here. I already had that highlighted. So this is just getting a reference to the actual DOM element where we're going to draw this grid. All right. The next thing that we need to do is we need to set our canvas width and height. So we're going to say canvas dot width, and this is going to be equal to settings dot cell size times settings dot width. All right, and then we're going to do the same thing. Canvas dot height is going to be equal to settings dot cell size times settings dot height. Now, in order to actually draw the grid, what we basically need to do is we need to loop through all of the rows and columns and draw a square around each individual cell. So we're going to need a couple nested for loops. So let's start. I'm going to put a little bit of extra spacing here to try and make it a little bit easier to read. So let's do 4. We're going to do var I is equal to 0, and we'll do this for all of the rows. We know how many rows there are by the height, right? So for I is less than settings dot height, and then we'll increment I for each time, and then we need 4. We're going to do the same thing with j is equal to 0. J is less than settings dot width, and then we need J++. So inside this for loop, what we need to do is we're going to we're going to tell the 2D context inside the canvas element to move to the very top, the top left of each cell, and then we're going to tell it to begin drawing a line, and we're going to draw it around each of the four sides, and then tell it to draw a stroke. So one thing that I actually didn't do yet, is we need to get that context. So let's create a variable called CTX for context is going to be equal to canvas.getContext. And then tell it to get the 2D context. So now, inside of here, we need to tell it first where it needs to go. So we need to go to CTX. We need to tell it to move to. And then the top left is going to be I times the cell size. And J times the cell size. So this is the XY coordinate that we're moving to. So the XY coordinate is going to be, for the very top right, or very top left cell, the top left of that cell is going to be 0, 0, right? So I is going to be 0, and J is going to be 0. So it's going to tell it to move to 0, 0 coordinate, right? And then the next time the J loops, J is going to be equal to 1, so it's going to move to, I is still 0, so it's going to move 0 to 1 times whatever the cell size is, just 25, so it's going to move to cell 0, 25, and so on and so forth. So it's moving to the top left corner of the current cell. Then we need to tell it to begin drawing a path, so we're going to do ctx.beginPath, and then we need to tell it where to draw a line, right? So it's ctx.line2, and then again this takes the xy coordinate. So we need to tell this to move to the top right now. So for the very first cell, that's going to be 0, 25. So we're still going to have I times settings dot cell size here. But then we're going to move to J times settings dot cell size plus settings dot cell size. All right. So let's copy this. We're going to tell it to move four times, right? So this first line, it just drew a line to the top right corner. Now we need to move it to the bottom right corner. So again, we can just, in this first parameter here, tell it to move to the bottom right corner. Then we need to move to the bottom left corner. So we'll add cell size to the first coordinate and remove it from the second coordinate. And then we need to go back to the top right, so we'll remove this. So that's what this is doing. So again, remember cell size is 25 here. So let's just say, let's kind of walk through this for the very first cell. So the very top left cell, the very first time this loop runs, I is going to be equal to 0, j is going to be equal to 0, and then cell size is equal to 25. So we're telling it to start at I, which is 0 times 25, which is 0, and 0 times 25, which is 0. So it's starting at cell 00. Then it's going to begin drawing. Then it's going to move the line to 0, and then 0 plus 25. So it's going to go to 0, 25. Then we're going to tell the cell to go to 0 plus 25, 0 plus 25, which is cell 25, 25. Then we're going to tell it to move the line to 25, 0, right? Which is the bottom left corner of the first cell. And then we're going to tell it to move back to 0, 0, which is the top right corner. So it just drew a line. It drew a box. And then the last thing we need to do is tell it to actually stroke that line. And we're going to let it use the default black stroke. So ctx.stroke is the function. So if we did that right, we should see a grid being drawn. Oh, and I had a typo here on line 28. Right here. And I copied that. Copied that typo. I typed setting instead of settings. So every time we see a setting, change it to settings. Which I believe that is all of them right there. So let's save that and give that another try. And now we have our grid. One thing I am noticing here is that this line all the way across the left-hand side didn't render properly. And I'm not 100% sure why, but if I go in here, before I stroke it, come in here and tell the context to close path, and then refresh, we get that line. So that's one little change we had to make there. All right, so let's go back and look at our code. And what is the next thing that we need? We're drawing our grid here. And I'm just gonna go ahead and get rid of this console, because we know that that's working fine. And this is pretty self-explanatory. We don't need a comment for it. All right, so we have our grid. What's the next thing we're gonna need? Well, we need a snake, right? So let's create a snake object. And let's think about what we need in our snake, right? What are the properties that our snake is gonna have? And what is the, what are the methods it's going to need? What sort of things will it need to do? The first thing we're going to need to know about our snake is probably the parts, right? If you think about it, the snake is made up of a bunch of individual components. Every time you eat, it grows by one. I'm going to call it pieces. And I'm going to store all those pieces inside of an array. And this is an object, so I don't need a semicolon there. The snake is also going to need It's gonna need to be able to move, right? So let's create a move property. Pieces is the colon property there, right? So this is gonna be a function. Right? And again, as a sanity check, I'm just gonna put some console log here of snake moving. So the snake is gonna need to move. The snake is gonna need some pieces to it. We're probably gonna need color. And I'm gonna go ahead and set this to a nice dark red, because that's what I like. What else are we going to need? We're probably gonna need to know what direction the snake is moving in, right? And I'm gonna just default this to right. What else are we gonna need to know about our state? Our snake. I'm getting hungry here. Our snake is gonna have to eat, right? And eat is gonna be a function. So we'll console log eating here. And I don't need that. I keep on forgetting I'm in an object here. And our snake is probably gonna just, it's gonna need one function that controls the moving and the eating. So I'm gonna create a function here called living, or live. And this will control the eating and the moving. So I'll just say snake living here. We'll actually need to draw pieces of the snake. We'll need to erase pieces of the snake. So let me call make draw a function. And then I'm going to go ahead and make erase a function. All right, so where do we go from here? Where do we actually start with our snake here? All right, so I imagine the very first thing we're going to do is obviously draw the snake in its initial position. So inside of my init, I'm going to call snake.draw. And what it actually needs to do, we'll come back to this in a second. So we're going to draw the snake. If we come back to our draw function, we need to know what we're going to draw. So let's look at, we need the coordinates. And let's actually just go back to our page here real quick and just make sure, yep. Our drawing snake function got called. Great. But we need the coordinates. So the best thing to do is we're actually going to pass in this pieces object. So we're going to pass in snake.pieces. And we'll explain a little bit more when we get into it a little bit. But what we're going to draw is snake.pieces, and we're going to pull in the last object, the last element. So we can do that by pulling in snake.pieces.length minus one. So if there's only one piece of the snake, this is going to pull in the zero element. If there's two pieces, it's going to pull in the one element, so on and so forth. And we're actually going to give it an initial piece. And we're going to do that. We want to give it basically as close to the middle square as possible. So we're going to put it wherever the middle square is where we're going to put it. And we do that by taking math.floor. And I actually want to put this inside of its own array element. So let's do this, math.floor. And this is going to be the x coordinate. So we're going to go settings.width divided by 2. So this is going to give us the middle element. And in the case where there's an odd number of elements, so it'll just floor it down to the one below. So we need to do that. And then the y coordinate is going to be math. Dot floor settings dot height divided by 2. So this gives us an initial position, and then just to make sure we're getting it, we're going to console.log these chords. Refresh our page, and we are getting 7, 7, which is the middle element of the array. So now we can actually draw it. So we're going to draw a rectangle. So instead of console logging here, let's just actually draw our rectangle. So we need to set the fill style of the rectangle we're going to draw. We're actually going to draw a square, but it's a rectangle with even sides. So we're going to take our context, right? You know what we actually need to do? Is this context actually needs to be a global element. This needs to be exposed globally because we need to access this from multiple places. So what we actually need to do up here is create our canvas up here. And I'm going to set it to null initially. And then we also need context up here. And we're going to set that to null initially. So then what we can just do here is instead of creating this canvas element, we can just call settings.canvas. And now everywhere we reference canvas, we need to go up here and do it in the settings object. And then same thing, settings.ctx. Oops. Everywhere we reference canvas or context like this, we can just create the setting object. So you'll do this a lot when you're developing games or even other applications, you'll find that you need to kind of iterate as you go. Now that should work fine. This is empty now, so let me just make sure that nothing borked. Looks like we're still good. Good. So now we can reference settings.context. Fill style is what we want, and we're gonna set this to the color of the snake, and then we need to tell it to fill a rectangle. So we need to go to settings again, dot context, dot fill rectangle. And this takes four parameters, and it's the xy coordinates of the top left corner, and then the xy coordinate at the bottom right corner. And so to get to that, we are going to tell it the top left corner is going to be settings.cellsize times coordinates, right? Coords 0, which is going to be the x element at the top right corner, and then the same thing of settings. Dot cell size times chords 1, which is going to be the y coordinate, right? And then the Sorry, you know what? I misspoke a little bit. The four parameters are the top right corner, the coordinates of the top right corner, and then the length of the x and y sides. So we're actually going to draw this a little bit smaller, right? A little bit smaller than the actual rectangle. So let's just say we did this as settings dot cell size and then settings dot cell size, right? Let's just try that. And then that's all we need to actually draw. So we refresh. It says color is not defined. You know what? I need this dot color because this is an object. There we go. So now it's drawn in the square. But we want to make this up. In order to make it a little easier to see, I want to make this a little bit smaller. So I'm actually going to set the x and y coordinates up by 2 pixels each. And again, I guess. And then we want a border of 2 pixels around all sides, so we need to actually take the cell size minus 4 pixels on the x and y side. And if we do that, now we have a square that's a little bit smaller than the actual cell size. Okay, so now that we've got our snake drawn, let's think about what we need to do next. And the thing I want to focus on next is getting the food drawn on the board. So let's go back and look at our code. And we've got our snake object done. We're going to create, very similarly, a food object. We're going to need to know the position of our food. And that's going to be an array. And again, it's going to take x, y parameters. But we only need a single dimension array here because there's only going to be one piece of food on the array, or sorry, on the board at any given time. We're going to need to know the color of the food. And I'm going to set this to a green here. I'm not very nuanced here. We're going to need, our food is going to need, similar to snake, is going to need draw functions. So I should just say again, drawing food. Let me copy this. Do. And actually, I'll show you why later. We don't actually need an erase function for our food. And I believe that's all we're going to need for our food. But one thing I am going to do is I'm going to create a function out here called I'm just looking through here real quick. Did I looks like I somehow copied over my return statement here. That's easy enough to fix though. So we're going to create a function called say get coords, and this is going to get random coordinates in on the game board to place the food. So let's create that as a function, and then what this is going to do, I look at my notes real quick. We're going to create an x variable, and this is going to be set to math.floor, and we're going to create a random variable, a random number, and we're going to multiply it by settings width. I'm just going to floor that, right? And then we'll do the same thing for a y position, but that's going to be times settings.height. But then what we need to do is we need to make sure that we're not placing any food on top of any piece of the snake, right? So we need to check every position, every piece of the snake, and make sure that we're not on here. So let's create a for loop, right? And we'll use I as our counter variable. Say I is less than snake.pieces.length. And then again, we'll increment I. And what we're going to do is we're going to say if snake.pieces I 0, which is the x coordinate of the ith element of the snake, is equal to the x pos, or snake dot pieces I 1, which is the y position of the ith element of the snake, is equal to the y pos. We are going to tell this to return a new coordinate. Otherwise, if we don't, we're going to return x pos, an array of x pos, y pos. So this should get us a random variable. So then what we're going to do is we're going to set this pos to get chords to the value. So this is going to give us an initial position. So let's call up here, we want food.draw. So as soon as we draw our snake, we want call food.draw. I expect to see an error, and let's see if that happens. All right, get chords is not a function. We need to be careful here about the order that we're defining our functions, because at the time that we're trying to get our position here, we haven't yet defined our getChords function. So let's move this up to right here. So now if we refresh, our function is getting called, we're calling drawing food. So let's actually instead log the position. I always do this, we're inside an object, so I need to call this dot position. So now we see 14.6, we refreshed a few times, 9.10, 8.5. So now we just need to actually draw the food. And we're going to do this very similarly to how we did drawing the snake, except we're going to draw the food as a circle instead of a square. It's going to be a different color, but this will also just make it visually distinguished. So in order to do this, we need to, again, begin a path on our context. So let's call settings.ctx.beginPath. We're going to set the fill style equal to our color here. And then we're going to tell it to draw an arc. So we're going to call settings.ctx.arc, and again, this takes, you can see actually here, takes the x and y coordinates of, and this is going to be the center of the circle, which is important, the radius, a start angle and an end angle, and then anti-clockwise here is an optional parameter that we're not going to use. It doesn't really matter when you're drawing a full circle. So we're going to set this to a chords object, which we actually need to take this as a parameter, the coordinates. So 0, which is going to be the x, times settings.cellSize, which is going to be the top right corner. Or top left corner, sorry. So we need to actually move this in. We want this to be the center of the circle. So we need to add to it half of the cell size. So settings.cellSize not divided by 2. And we're going to do the same thing for the Y parameter. So let me just copy all this. The only difference being that this is going to be 1, which is the Y parameter. After that, we need to tell it the radius. So again, for this to be a radius of 21, we need this to be, a diameter of 21, we need the radius to be 9.5 pixels. We need the start angle and the end angle. And this is in radians. So you may recall that a full circle is 2 pi radians. So if we add in 2 times math.pi here, then that will give us our radius. So again, inside of our arc here, we're passing in the x-coordinate of the center of the circle, the y-coordinate of the center of the circle, the radius of the circle, the start angle of the circle, the end angle of the circle. And then we just need to tell it to fill the circle. So settings.context.fill. That should be it. So if we go back and refresh our code again. Color. Again, I keep on doing this. We're inside an object. I need this dot color. And then, of course, what we need to tell up here, we need to tell it to draw at food.pause. So now we have a circle, and it's going to move into a random place. So now we have our initial piece of our snake on the board, and we have our initial piece of food on the board. All right, so the next thing that we want to do is we actually want to make our snake start moving, right? Right. If we look at our code here, we can see we already have a move function, placeholder in place. So now we need to actually make it do something. So if we go back and look at our board here, let's say our snake is moving to the right. So what do we actually want to do when the snake moves? And we're not going to worry about eating right now, just moving. The first thing that, what we'd actually do is when the snake goes to move, we want to draw in, or let's say if we're moving to the right here, we draw in a new square to the right and then delete the last square. So if your snake is, 20 pieces long, there's no need to redraw all 20 pieces. We just need to draw one new one in the front and delete the last one in the back. So where we draw the new one is going to be dependent upon the direction the snake is moving, right? So the first thing that we need is a switch statement based on the direction of the snake, so this.direction. And inside of our switch statement, we'll have our cases, right? So let's say case left. We'll do something and then break, right? That's how these work. And then we need, for right, up, and down. So let's look at the right case, since our default direction is right. So what we want to do whenever the snake moves to the right, we want to add a new position, a new element to our pieces array, and it's going to be one cell to the right of whatever is the current, like the head of the snake. So what we want to do is we want to go look at this.pieces, and we're going to push a new element into the array. And what we're going to do is actually look at this.pieces of and we want to look at the last element in the array, right? So at position, this.pieces.length-1. And we want to look at the zeroth element of that array, which is the x coordinate. And we want to add 1 to it. So we're moving this 1 to the right. So the x-coordinate is going up by 1, but the y-coordinate is going to stay the same. So we can take this same expression right here for the y-coordinate, and we're going to look at the element at position 1, which is the y-coordinate. All right? And then we want to draw that piece, right? So we're going to say this dot draw, and the coordinates that we're going to pass in, again, is this dot pieces always fix your typos. But then we're going to draw this.pieces-1, dot length of minus 1. So we're going to draw the last piece of the snake. So let's try, in our knit function up here, let's try moving our snake. And you can see we moved. We moved one piece. Now, our move function is going to need to be continuously called, right? So once we call it, we need to call it again. So at the end of our move function, set timeout, move, and sorry, this.move. And oh wait, we need to call this again on an interval. Well, let me hard code an interval in real quick of 1,000 milliseconds or 1 second and refresh. And we should see every second. Actually, we don't need to call this.move, we need to call snake.move. Now we're moving, but why is this not drawing on more pieces? Let's take a look. So we take a look in the code here. We can see why this is not working. And it's a little bit complicated, but when it's calling snake.move down here, is calling this function again, but the second time it runs through this function, it doesn't have any reference to the original snake object, because this is a reference to the original snake object. But when it gets called a second time, it doesn't keep the reference to the original snake object, so this needs that to be actually an explicit reference to snake rather than this. And that actually applies to all of the places in here where I have called this, because when it's being called basically recursively by the setTimeout function, although it's not technically a recursive call, so an asynchronous call. When it's being called asynchronously, it doesn't have reference to the original snake object, but by explicitly referencing snake here, that should fix it. So now if we go back and look at our page, and refresh, we should see that every time we have our snake moving, it's adding on a new piece to the snake. So now we need to handle erasing the last piece of the snake. So I'm going to remove this console log now that we know this is working. Excuse me, and let's look at this erase function here. And the erase function is actually going to be pretty simple. What we're essentially going to do is every time we move the snake and add the new element onto the front, we're going to erase the element on the back, and we're going to do that by just drawing a white square over top of it. So it's actually going to look pretty similar to the draw function here. In fact, I'm even going to just copy this into the erase function, but we're going to pass in the coords again, and then rather than drawing it as a red square, I'm just going to hard code this in as being a white square. So then the only thing that we have to do is pass in the coordinates that we want it to erase, and we can actually take care of kind of two birds with one stone, because we need to do two things. We need to draw a white square over the element we're erasing, and then we actually need to remove that element from this pieces array. So what we can do is call snake.erase, and the coordinates that we want to pass in are the snake.pieces at the zeroth element. But what we can do is we want to erase it. We want to remove this from the array. So what we can actually do, rather than passing in those elements, we can just call snake.shift, not shaft, shift. And that will, what the shift function does on an array is it removes the very first element of the array and it returns that element. So when we call snake.shift, it's going to remove the element from the array and then it's going to return back. So this is going to get back the basically the coordinates of the first element. So if I save that and refresh it now, snake.shift, we want snake.pieces.shift, sorry. And now we see just that one piece going. So now what we can do is we can fill in the rest of our cases here for left, right, up, and down. And I'm going to do that off screen real quick, and then I'll come back and review it. All right, and I'm back, and I've filled in the left, up, and down cases, and then I also went down to this erase function and removed the console log we had in there. So what are we doing here? So if you remember the right case, when we were pushing in a new element to the array, we took basically the last x coordinate and added one to it and then kept the same y coordinate. So for the left case, we need to move in the opposite direction. So we take, again, the x coordinate and just subtract one from it, leave the y coordinate the same. And then the same concept for up, up and down, we leave the x coordinate alone and we modify the y coordinate. So to move it up, we subtract one from the y coordinate, and down we erase one from the we add one to the y coordinate. Now, in order to actually test these real quick, I'm just going to change the direction we have hard-coded in, the initial direction, and let's just make sure that works. So now you can see we're moving left. Let's try moving up. We're moving up. And now let's move down. Oh, we messed something up. We're moving diagonally. And you can see I'm down. I forgot to leave the x-coordinate alone. So let's save that and refresh. Now we are moving down properly. All right, so the next thing that we need to do is we actually need to be able to control the snake using arrow keys. So in order to do that, I'm going to set up some keybinds down here outside of the game object. In order to keybind in JavaScript, you can just do document dot on key up is what I'm going to use. There's on key down, on key press, on key up. I'm going to use on key up. The important distinction to note is, at least in Chrome, I'm not sure if it applies to all browsers, but on key press does not work with the arrow keys. So just something to note. So on key press, I'm going to it's going to set this to a function. I'm going to add a function call to it. It's going to get passed an event. And we're going to switch on that event dot key code. And we're going to add our cases in here. So we're going to use 37 through 40 are the arrow keys. And then just if you don't know, by the way, it's easy enough to find out just by doing console.log event.keycode. If I do that real quick and refresh, it's not going to like this. Oh, make sure I'm in the browser window. And you can see as I'm pressing the arrow keys, it's logging the key code. So if you don't know the key codes, that's an easy way to find them. So let me just add that switch statement back in. So we're going to switch on the event.keycode. And inside here, we're going to need our cases. So we're going to start with case 37. And I'm going to create a function in just a second that's going to be called game.snake.setDirection. And we're going to, this is left here, by the way. And then we're going to do the same thing for 38, 39, and 40. Oops. So 38, 39, and 40. And this 38 is up, 39 is right, 40 is down. So inside of our game.snake.setDirection, inside a snake, we need a set direction function. And in here, this is going to take a dir for direction. So we're going to say snake dot direction is equal to dir. And then inside of here, what we're actually going to do, I'm going to change this a little bit, set snake direction is going to be the function name, and this is going to be equal to snake dot set direction. So let me update that down here. So it's going to be game.setSnakeDirection. And then as we, if we save and refresh that now, we should be able to set the direction, which it doesn't look like it's doing. So let's just do some troubleshooting. See if it's even being called. And it is. For some reason, it's being called twice every time. That's interesting. And let's just have it. That's quite interesting. I don't know why it's getting called with down every time. Oh, hello. Because I'm not breaking. So that should at least fix it being called more than once. Oh, and you can see now it is properly changing the direction. It was just getting hard-coded to down because I didn't put my breaks and my switch statements correctly. So now our snake can move around. But when we move over our food, nothing happens other than we drew over those cells so the food goes away. So now let's look into making sure that our food eating is working properly. Alright, so when our snake eats, we basically just want to check if the head of the snake, or the first, or actually in our array, that the element in the last position, we want to check to see if it's equal to the position of the food. And if it is, we'll consider the snake to eat the food, and then we will tell the food to regenerate somewhere else. So when we eat here, again, we want to check if the snake.position we want snake.pieces, right? We want the last piece, so snake.pieces.length minus 1, and if the x coordinate, so the first coordinate there, is equal to our food dot position x coordinate, and we can then copy and paste this. So if the x coordinate is the same and the y coordinate is the same, then let's just console log to see if this works, right? Food eaten. And then where do we want to tell the snake to eat? Well, when the snake is moving, let's see here. When the snake is moving, after we add on the new piece, right? So after we add on the new piece, and then after we draw it, we can try eating. So let's just try eating there, and we're going to set the default back to right. Now let's check and see what happens. Oop, eat is not defined because it will be this dot. Or snake dot eat. So again, this is only, we're only calling it from the right one right now. So we need to come in from the right and go over this piece of food. Oh, food eating. This is just still in here. So we ate the food, right? Fantastic. Well, when we eat the food, we want to... let's find our food object again, sorry. Our eat function. When we eat the food, we want to tell it to draw new food somewhere else. So we're going to say food dot pause, we need a new position, right? Is equal to get coordinates. And then we want to tell the food to draw. And at food dot pause. So let's go ahead and add the snake eating function everywhere else. for the rest of the directions. So now when we refresh, no matter what direction we come into the food, we should see it eat, and then we should also see, there we go, a new piece of food. Now obviously our snake didn't grow, so that's our next thing that we need to figure out. And now believe it or not, we are getting fairly close to being done here. What we really have left to do is we need our snake to grow, and we need to build in some collision detection. So one thing I'm going to look into or look at real quick is our snake function, our snake object. I want to add in a speed here, and this is going to be speed in milliseconds. I'm going to set our snake speed to right now 500 milliseconds, so that every half second our snake moves. And now in our set timeout function here, we can call snake dot speed. And let me just test that real quick. See, now our snake moves a little faster. Should make some testing a little better now. So now every time that our snake eats, we want the snake to grow, right? Let me get that out of the console. So how do we do that? Well, you can see that our erase function here is what's removing the last piece of the snake. So we don't want this to happen if the snake successfully eats. So what we need to do out of our eat function is we need it to return back whether or not it successfully ate. So if it does successfully eat, let's return true here. And then if it doesn't, we can return false. So now we can wrap this erase function in an if statement. So we can say if the snake does not eat, then erase. Right? And then, so this will make the snake try and eat. And if that returns false, so the snake does not eat, then we can erase the last piece. But if it does eat, we'll just skip the erasing. So let's try that and see how that works. So in the rest of the directions here, let me just replace the eat and the erase. Save it. Now let's refresh. Now let's go eat some food and see what happens. Oh, now when I ate the food, it didn't erase the last piece and I grew by one. So now we are getting really, really close to being done here. So we need to now build in the collision detection both with the world border or the edge of the grid, and also with itself. If the snake collides with any of its own pieces, it's going to need to die, if you will. So let's look and do how we can solve for that. So if we look at our functions here, if we look at our move cases here, let's think about what happens. Let's think about in our first case here, we're moving left. When the snake is attempting to move left off the edge of the world border, we need to think about, is it going to move past zero in the negative direction? So let me switch back to my game here real quick and I'll show you what I mean. So I refresh and start a new game, and I start moving left here. And it's going to move left off the screen. So when it gets to this last cell here and it's trying to move left again, is its top right coordinate going to move past zero in the negative direction? We can check that. If we look at, so if we say if, So if it's trying, basically what we can say is if the top left coordinate, that's the x coordinate of the head of the snake, is already zero and it's trying to move left, then game over. So what we can do here is say if snake dot pieces, and we want the last piece, so we can get that by saying snake dot pieces dot length minus one. So the at the last index, at the index of the length minus one, if it is greater than zero, then we can move. If it's not greater than zero, then we're not going to move. So that's all we're going to do right now, is we're basically just going to tell it, don't do anything. We can just do this, console log game over, right? Just to indicate that this is the game over scenario. So now, if we refresh, sorry, and I try and, ooh. Ah, you know what? We want the index output of position 0. So now if we move left, we hit the edge of the screen. Now game over. And now we haven't built in the game over mechanism, so it's going to keep on trying to move left, but we're not letting it. So now let's look at how we would implement that for trying to move right. Now to move right, we want to check what it's doing when it moves off the edge of the world on the right side. So we still want to look at the same coordinate, but we want to check that this coordinate is less than the settings dot width times the settings dot cell size minus settings dot cell size, and we'll look at that in just a second. So let's refresh. It's gonna move right, and it should have stopped right there. Type. If I did this wrong, we'll take a look at the code here in just a second. So the x coordinate of the head of the snake is less than settings.width. Settings dot cell size. And technically, it should be the same up here, although it doesn't really matter because it's zero either way. But now let's refresh. And now we're stuck at the right. So if we take a look at settings.cellSize, let's actually just look at this. So settings.cellSize 25 times 15, and the cell size is minus 25. So it's basically saying if the top right corner is already right here, so settings.cellSize times our width is going to put us right here, and if we subtract our cell size, it's going to be right here. So if it's saying if our top right coordinates of our box is already right here, then, and it's trying to move right again, we know it's going to move off the edge of the world border, edge of the grid here, so we're going to stop it from doing that. Now we haven't actually made a game over scenario, so I can still go back and move a different direction. So we do need to build in that game over mechanism. We're going to do it in a really simple way, but that's what we're going to do. So now we can do up and down. And it's going to be the same concept, except here we're going to be looking at the first index, which is the Y coordinate. And we can indent all this properly. And then if we copy what we're doing for right, move that to down. Again, the same concept. We want to be looking at the first index right here. And we want to look at the height, even though our width and height are the same right now. If we were to change them to the different values, we would need that to be reflected properly. So now if we go look at up, which is stop moving, and then down, when we get to the bottom, which is stop moving. And then just to make this consistent, I'm going to go ahead and add in the game overs down here. All right, so we built in the detection for hitting the world border. Now let's look at adding in detection for the snake running into itself. So the colliding is actually not too bad. We just need a helper function for our colliding, and every time that we're gonna try and move, we can just check and see if our head intersects with any other piece of the body. So let's build a new helper function, and as actually a little bit of cleanup, we're not actually going to use this live function. So I'm going to go ahead and erase that, but we're going to create a new one called check collision. We're going to set this as a function. And inside this function, this function is actually going to take some coordinates as a parameter. And what we need to do, the coordinates that it's going to get passed is the head of the snake. And we just need to check that the coordinates are not interfering with any other piece of the snake. So we can just do a for loop. And then again, we're going to use I as our counter. And we're going to run this for I is less than snake dot pieces dot length. And we're going to increment I at the end of every loop. And we're just going to check to see if snake dot pieces I 0, which is the x coordinate, is equal to coordinates 0, and snake dot pieces I 1, which is the y coordinate, is equal to coordinates 1, which is the y coordinate, then we're going to return true, and then otherwise we are going to return false. And then we can just call this check collision when we attempt to move. And so what we do is we say, if we look at the left scenario, in order to move, we need to check that we're not going to collide, and then we also need to check that we do not check collision, and we're going to pass in the coordinates right here that we would be trying to pass in next. So we're going to do that for all four directions. So snake.checkCollision, and then again pass in these coordinates here that we would be trying to go to next. So we did that for left and right. Now let's do it for up. Take the next coordinate that we would be going to if we were going to be going up. And then last but not least, we're going to go to down and say, and we do not collide with this coordinate here. So let's save that, go back to our page here, refresh, and let's check a couple. And one thing I'm actually going to do real quick before we get too far in is in our snake, I'm going to change our speed to 250 milliseconds to get a little faster. So let me build up a few. Catch one, or let me eat one more food, and then I'm gonna try and eat myself. Oh, end game is over. So that works. Now, we could pretty much call this done at this point, but there are actually three quick little things that I do want to fix or improve. The first is I want to prevent the player from being able to reverse direction. That's going to cause an issue because, especially if you have more than one piece, if you reverse direction, then you're going to collide with your tail right away, right? So if I'm going down and I press up, well, then I just collided with my tail. So I want to prevent you from being able to change direction. And then another enhancement we need to make to the direction as well is... I want to make it so that you can only change direction once per move, and that's to prevent you from taking a tight corner, and if you try and if you're trying to take a tight corner and you want to like flip a U real quick, if you go too fast, it's going to register both arrow moves before the snake actually moves, and again, move you back in the wrong direction. So those first two are related to moving. And then the last one is I just want you to be able to reset the game by pressing spacebar if you die, so you don't have to refresh the page, although it's not a huge deal with the game. It's simple to refresh the page each time. So let's look at the code for changing direction again. And we're doing pretty darn simple here. In order to prevent you from being able to change directions, if you are already moving left, if you're already moving left, in order to prevent you from being able to say move right, which means basically heading in the opposite direction, we can look at this set snake direction function. So let's scroll up here until we hit that set snake direction function, which should be right here. So what we can do, say, is if snake dot direction does not equal direction already, then that prevents you from doing it the same. So what we can actually do to make it a little cleaner is switch here. So switch on the direction. So case right. No, we'll keep it in the same direction so left, up, right, down. We can say if snake dot direction does not equal right, then snake dot direction is equal to direction, and then break. Let's copy this down. So here we want left, down, and up, right? So that takes care of that. So now should be able to, 114, I messed something up. I spelled switch. So now, let me get this. I shouldn't be able to, and I can't. I can't backtrack at all. That's good. So in order to check if I'm able to change direction, I need a property for my snake. We'll call it can change direction. And we're going to set that to true by default. And then every time we change direction, we'll set snake.can change direction to false. Update that. And then when we actually move the snake, every time the snake actually moves, we can add in, we can change the snake dot can change direction, change that to true. So every time we actually move the snake, we can update it to say that it is able to change direction now. And I always do this inside of an object. That needs to be a comma. And now if we refresh, I messed something up. I need to add in a snake that can change direction. So we need to actually check if we can change direction. And then for some reason, here we go. So now you can't really tell, but if I hit two arrow keys very quickly back and forth, so here I'm gonna hit left and down really fast, and I'll only went left. So that prevents you from being able to accidentally backtrack by pressing keys too quickly. And then the very, very last thing that we can do is make it so that when you are stopped, when the game is over, you can refresh it by pressing the spacebar. So let me go back into my code here. So that means we're going to need a game setting to understand if the game status and the values are going to be either we can make it stopped or started. So we'll put a default value of started in, then when we're trying to move, we will have a check to make sure that the game started. And we don't actually need to do it when we're trying to move. We need to do it when we are trying to move again. So let me look at the move function. And here, when we're setting timeout, we can check if settings.status is equal to started, then we can set timeout. And then every time we're game over here, we can actually set this to stopped. And then inside of our init function, where is our init function? We can set settings.status is equal to started. And then in that case, we can actually make the default status stopped. And now if we refresh, everything should work as fine as we expect. This should still stop you. Now, the last thing that we can do is set a keybind to the space key. And the key code for the space key is 32. So we can create a new case for 32. And then what we can do is check to see if the game is stopped. So what we need to do is we need to check if we'll do game.getStatus is equal to stopped. So if the game is stopped, then we will do game.setStatus and we will pass in started. So we need to create these getStatus and setStatus. So inside of our game where we're returning, we'll do get status, and we will return to that. So we'll set that as a function that returns settings.status, and then set status. We'll set that to a function that takes in the status. We'll call this new status. And set settings.status is equal to new status. So that should allow us, if we refresh, if we hit the wall, we should be able to hit space. Nothing's happening. So let's do some console logins to see where we are. So first, let's just see if the space, if it registers that the space is pressed. All right, now let's see if it logs that we're in here. Huh. So now let's see if we're in get status. This is how you troubleshoot, you just constantly. All right. So let's see what the actual setting set statuses. Let me do this. It still thinks we're started. No, stop, 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 stop. So for some reason, we're not setting this still thinks that the game has started. So somewhere we are not moving right. But we're not It looks like I'm going to stop the recording here for just a minute, and I'm going to troubleshoot why this setting the status to stop doesn't seem to be working, and then I'll come back once we've got it resolved. All right, guys, I'm back, and probably all of you immediately saw my mistake. I made the classic easy mistake of, in my if statement here, I'm using the assignment operator rather than the comparison operator. So if I change that, then that should fix our problem straight away. And now if I hit spacebar, all right, we see the game has stopped. So now let's continue working on getting this to work. So in our set status, what we actually need to do is, rather than just setting the status with the new status, we need to set that, we actually just need to call, rather than, we just need to get status, we need to, rather than setting the status again, we actually just need to re-init the game. So we're going to do that. So we're going to call this re-init. Doesn't need any parameters. The status is going to be started. We actually don't even need to set the status. We just need to call init. Again, let's try that. And what we need to do with our init function, as I'm playing around with that, is we need to reset the snake dot direction. So snake dot direction is equal to right, and then we need to override the pieces again, so there's only one piece. So snake dot pieces is equal to that, and that should get us back to a place where if we hit spacebar, it re-inits us. Ah, but our old snake is left. So we need to erase the entire snake. So I'll pause for that, and then we'll add that in, that erase function in. Let me just double check this. Yeah, it's leaving in part of the old snake. So we'll fix that, and then I think we'll be done. All right, and that last bug was just simply a matter of resetting the resetting the snake before drawing the first piece. So you can see that we had the draw function before we had the function that was resetting the pieces. So it was drawing the last piece of the old snake before it was resetting the snake. So if we reset the snake first and then draw, now when we refresh and reset the game, then it does properly reset. And then even if we have a couple pieces of food eaten and we reset the game, then we're all good. So that's it. That is the game done and dusted. So we'll just eat a few pieces on the way out. I hope you guys enjoyed watching this video. I know it was quite a long one, but if you think about it, we managed to develop an entire snake game from scratch using vanilla JavaScript in one video. So that's pretty awesome, if you ask me. I really hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please like the video to let me know that you enjoyed it. If you have any questions or comments, then please leave a comment below, and subscribe to the channel so you can get more updates when I upload more videos in the future. And please let me know what kind of videos you'd like to see. This is a pretty new channel, so I'm pretty open to exploring new ideas and making new kinds of videos. So again, thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.